going to ask Jill Wilson to come and introduce Kathleen.
Thank you, Peter. Hi, everyone. My name is Jill Wilson. I have the great honor to introduce my awesome aunt. So for 50 years, Kathleen has worked as an advocate for children and the Montessori pedagogy, as a classroom teacher, an administrator, a teacher trainer, an author, an administrator, a presenter, a past CMS president, and conference chair, and mentor and a friend. She is a lifelong learner. She has always continued to stay on top of current literature, reading everything that she can get her hands on brain development, and assimilating these new discoveries with what Dr. Montessori said in her writings 100 years ago. And even in her retirement now, she continues to volunteer her services at whatever opportunity presents itself, sharing her knowledge and experience with those that ask. 50 years of supporting, educating, and loving children, parents, teachers, and colleagues, countless number of people have been deeply impacted by your generosity, your patience, and your passion. Most importantly, me and my family. I couldn't have done this without you. I am blessed and extremely proud and grateful to have been born your niece and to share the passion of Montessori with you. So on behalf of all these people, we thank you for all that you've done and all that you still do. And just know that your legacy will continue and inspire for many generations to come. Cincinnati Montessori Society and OMA for the great honor of this recognition. In 1959, after a year of college, I had no idea what I wanted to be when I grew up. But I knew one thing, and that is I did not want to be a teacher. I did not want to be involved in any schooling or any system of education. Growing up in West Virginia, I thought that maybe I might want to work with the in the mountains and the people in the south. The Glenberry community of sisters, priests, and brothers was dedicated to the people of Appalachia and to the southern communities. And so I entered that women's religious community. 26 of us entered that year. The Glenberry sisters community was growing and space was needed for living quarters. And so the Glenberry sisters purchased some abandoned buildings in the old St. Aloysius Boys Military Academy, about 50 miles east of Cincinnati. And our group, 26 strong, was assigned to go and renovate those buildings. The neighbors in that small town of Fayetteville, Ohio, welcomed us with vegetables from their gardens and homemade pastries and live chickens. And they taught us how to kill and prepare those chickens for freezing. So one day, I was assigned to the chicken killing committee with all apologies to chickens everywhere, to PETA, and to vegetarians. I apologize. But after my chicken had died, and and was dipped in hot water. I carried it into this big industrial kitchen with a large island counter that was covered inches thick with newspapers and magazines. Now, during those first years of formation in religious life, you are not allowed to read secular newspapers or magazines. So a whole counter covered with newspapers and magazines, yes, thank you, Jesus. So I chose a space on that counter, placed my chicken down, and began plucking the feathers, anxious to read what was ever there. And right to the left of where I placed my chicken was a magazine open to the very page of an article written by Nancy McCormick Rainbush about this Montessori thing and this Whitby school in Connecticut and this American Montessori Society. And I began reading and plucking and reading and plucking and was fascinated by this new system of education and the environmental design of this prepared environment and the didactic materials and the role of the adult as directors. And the children were free to move and to choose. I was really curious. Then I was assigned to Southeast Georgia to work in the 10 counties south of Augusta and west of Savannah. This was in the year 1962. It was 2 years before the passing of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and segregation was everywhere. White-only signs at the drinking fountains, separate windows at the ice cream stands, separate restaurants and public bathrooms and churches and schools, all were segregated. I became very involved in the Human Rights House, working alongside members of the African American community in support of the human and civil rights and integration. I sat alongside the blacks in sit-ins and marched in freedom marches and school boycotts and visited the black families on the cotton plantations. The Ku Klux Klan was active and rode through and dropped burning crosses on our meetings. I was especially interested in the children, and I renovated an old hut for Saturday programs and invited children from diverse racial and cultural backgrounds to come together and just get along, and they did. After 3 years in Georgia, I was assigned to the House of Studies at Marquette University, where I studied sociology and psychology to continue my interest in work in community and human development. I became involved in the civil rights movement in Milwaukee. I left the Glen Mary community in 66 and returned to Milwaukee to finish my degree. And near the end of my graduation, the head of the sociology department was discussing with me a fellowship being offered at Harvard University for a doctorate in human and community development when I received a phone call from the president of the board of directors of Seton Montessori School in Clarendon Hills, Illinois, where Selma P. Perry was the director. They were offering a scholarship to a Montessori teacher education program and invited me down for an interview. Unbeknownst to me, a Glen Mary sister, Sister Janine Schmidt, who had attended that first Montessori teacher education program in Greenwich under the direction of Nancy Rambush, was aware of that scholarship and had read a letter of recommendation. I received a scholarship and through the generosity of Seton attended the AMS Montessori Teacher Education Program at Fairleigh Dickinson University in 1967. Nancy Rambush was the director and one of the instructors, and she had brought that course down to affiliate with the Graduate Department of Psychology at FDU. There were 62 adult students in that year's course. I interned at Seton and taught there for a year. Then I was asked by Janine to come to Cincinnati and teach at the Montessori Center Rooms because she was leaving to obtain a doctorate. So why, you may be asking yourselves, would I want to become involved in Montessori and I did not want to be a teacher. I did not want to be connected with any schools or any system of education. Because from the moment I first read that article, plucking that chicken, as interesting as this new method of education, the new role of teacher as directors, and as fascinating as the prepared environment and those didactic materials, it was not about education. It was about human rights. The human and civil rights of all children at all stages. The Montessori philosophy, principles, program, practices, and profession spoke to me of human and community development, about creating a caring, compassionate community in support of the development of each unique child, where autonomy, the experience of oneself as the origin of one's own decision-making, was strong. Where self-determination, self-actualization, and self-regulation were encouraged and supported. Where a sense of belonging could be deeply experienced. And where competency could be developed in all areas, feeling effective within the community. All of this within an integrated community of development by stages, not ages. Where the children were not segregated by age, five-year-olds, six-year-olds, or grades, kindergarten, first grade, or evaluative grades, A student, B student, where the adult was more a facilitator than an educator, an aid, a guide, where the rights and needs of each individual child were recognized, respected, and realized. Maria Montessori called for a revolution in society's approach to human development, a radically different view of human nature. And I have been fortunate to be a part of that revolution for the past 50 years. With deep gratitude to many of you here with whom I share this journey, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of my son, Eric, who is here today. Eric has been the motivation and inspiration for me for almost all of those 50 years. Eric started his Montessori journey when he was 2 years old, when Hilda Rothschild invited him to come to the summer program at Xavier University in their demonstration class. He continued to the primary and elementary at Children's Meeting House. And with his unique intelligence and insights and abilities and humor, he has created a most amazing young man, of whom I am most proud and most grateful. Thank you.
Introduce choose Monique Rothschild to accept this honor.
Everybody hear me okay? Well, I am honored to share a little information about an amazing woman, Hilda Rothschild. Despite my gray hair, which might suggest that I was around and had the opportunity to know and the good fortune to know Hilda, I never got to meet her. But I did get to meet her lovely daughter, and she's with us here this afternoon. Hilda was born in Germany in 1913, one of four daughters of a prosperous Jewish family. When she understood the direction of Germany under Hitler's rise to power, Hilda left for France in 1933, where she would live for the next 9 years. It was in Paris where she overheard two nursemaids talking about children and a new philosophy that advanced freedom for children to learn in an environment that was carefully prepared. She enrolled in a Montessori course where many of her lectures that she attended were presented by Dr. Montessori herself. When France became an occupied country in 1941, she and her husband Ernest fled with their baby daughter, Monique, to North America. They settled in Cincinnati, which was Hilda's home for the rest of her life. And I just want everybody just to take a minute and just think about this, because this is the importance of the history of knowing all these lovely Montessorians. Here we are. You're going to be in the presence of Monique, who was the daughter of Hilda, who was a student of Maria and Mario Montessori. And many of our distinguished Montessorians were that close to Dr. Montessori herself. So Hilda's daughter, Monique, would you please come and join me up on the stage and say a few remarks about your mother?
In Cincinnati. Last year, I was proud to attend Xavier Montessori's 50th anniversary celebration, where my mother Hilda was again recognized. I didn't have to say a word that time, except maybe thank you, but I did help prepare the introduction. For this afternoon, I was given an assignment to share Hilda Rothschild's pearls of wisdom about early childhood education and Montessori in particular. Being the rebel I've been since childhood, I won't be speaking on that subject. Rather, I'm going to share with you the pearls of her person, pearls that her students and all Montessorians can inherit and use as guiding principles of their lives. I want to share my insights into her character, the persona that made her respected and loved by so many. What were some of the characteristics that shaped her and enabled her to attract such a following? Hilda was the following things: ethical, determined, independent, courageous, intelligent, a pioneer, a diligent worker, and a survivor. In 1933, as a 20-year-old Jewish student at the University of Frankfurt, Hilda experienced firsthand the early effects of the Nazi takeover in Germany. Early that spring, she returned to Hamburg to let her family know she could not remain at the university or in their country. Seeing the writing on the wall, she abandoned her studies and without money or her parents' blessings, she left for Paris, in the country that had authored the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen in 1783. "I didn't leave for an education," she said, "but to be a free human being. Human rights, freedom, and democracy for children as well as adults were absolute necessities to her." Sounds a little like what Kathleen thought when she gave her talk about freedom and democracy and human rights. The following year, Hilda attended the Maria Montessori International Training Program in Nice. Knowing no one, she packed up and traveled south. 2 months later, she returned to Paris with her diploma. After a one-year internship, she continued teaching until the Nazis occupied France in 1940. From then on, her considerable energies and indomitable courage were directed at saving her infant daughter and arranging the release of her husband from the labor camp where he was imprisoned, and above all, finding a way out of a country that had turned from a refuge into a place of mortal danger. Arriving in Cincinnati in 1941, Hilda again concentrated on her family, on settling into a second new life, caring for her daughter, and helping her husband, whose English was not as good as her own. After 8 years in conventional nursery schools, she was hired by the Council of Jewish Women to head their new project, first nursery school anywhere that would be dedicated exclusively to the education of young children with cerebral palsy. She was a pioneer. With their help, Hilda bypassed the requirement for a bachelor's degree and enrolled in the University of Syracuse master's program in special education. Without that master's degree, she could not have gone on to Xavier to help create the first university-based graduate Montessori degree program. But before that third innovation, she started the first Montessori class in the area at Cincinnati Country Day School. Her charisma and intelligence had earlier been recognized in another very different realm. In 1949, she was selected valedictorian of her citizenship class, and 2 months later was asked to represent that class at I Am an American Day celebration in Washington Park. Some quotes from her speech that day are pure Hilda and have relevance for all of us today. "Democracy in the United States is more than a political conception. It is a way of life. Each new citizen of this country is not only permitted to contribute to its development, but welcome and urge to do so. As research has shown, only a feeling of being wanted and of being useful can produce a sense of security. The United States derives its strength from the accomplishment of this basic psychological concept. I am sure I am speaking for every one of the new Americans if I say that celebrating I Am an American Day means more to us than it can ever mean to any American citizen who had the great good fortune of being born in this country. By becoming citizens of our own free will and choice, we pledge to fulfill the utmost duties of a citizen with a fuller knowledge of the implications of what being a citizen means. We also know that the citizenship we now share is more demanding than ever. The dynamic force which underlies this country's greatness is the result of the contributions made constantly by its people. There is no standstill here. This constant striving for betterment has kept the United States from shrinking culturally and politically. The people who have brought along with them the riches of the civilizations from their former countries have become active partners in American civilization. This is what keeps America alive and strong. Shortly before her death in 1984, Hilda was awarded an honorary doctorate from Xavier University. The citation accompanying her degree praises the philosophy she expressed as giving roots and wings to children, as well as her brilliant and personalized involvement with each of the teaching interns who come from all over that laid the foundation of Xavier's Montessori programs. In 1983, she told an interviewer, "Nobody remembers that I ever did anything else in this city. They say, here comes that Montessori woman, as if I was Maria Montessori herself." So I point with pride to my mother and her historic contributions to the field of education, especially in her years at the Cerebral Palsy Center, Cincinnati Country Day School, and finally at Xavier University. It's over 30 years since my mother died, and I can't help wondering that she thinks that I'm the one who should be getting all this recognition. It's been a pleasure to be here with you today, and as a daughter and as a fellow Montessorian, to honor the memory and lasting influence of Hilda Freundlich Rothschild. And I thank all of you who invited us to be here today, and Barb for her lovely, loving introduction.
Thank you, Monique. We sure are glad that Hilda did give roots to Montessori here in Cincinnati and links to all of us to spread it. So on behalf of the Ohio Montessori Alliance, I'd like to present this plaque. And our third distinguished Ohio Montessorian from the Southwest region is Robyn Breiman. Robyn, unfortunately, is not able to be here with us today, but I'd like to call Vanessa Rigo forward to introduce Robyn, and Martha McDermott, who's going to accept this award for Robyn.
Good afternoon. Today I have the distinct privilege of introducing my former teacher and mentor, Robyn Breiman. It was about 45 years ago that she had the opportunity of discovering Montessori at the New School for Social Research in New York City. She later went to Xavier University and obtained her master's degree and her Montessori credentials for EC, Elementary 1 and Elementary 2. Robyn Breiman worked at the New School for over 22 years until 2001, where she retired as head of school. Robyn's strong advocacy for higher fidelity in Montessori work in the upper elementary presented a curriculum that was implemented in all Montessori schools in the U.S., the Senior Project, a year-long research paper for sixth graders. She has published several articles in Montessori Life, and her most recent one was about the importance of keeping sixth grade in the upper elementary rather than moving sixth grade to the middle school. In the early 1980s, Robyn began teaching students at Xavier University and CMTE. At CMTE, she was the coordinator of the Montessori program, and her colleagues at CMTE created the first 9 to 12 standalone program. Now, 17 years later, she is delighted to see that AMS and MACD have agreed to support programs to offer a credential again. In 2013, Robyn and her former colleagues from CMTE collaborated to found METSI, the Montessori Teacher Training Collaboration, where she served as co-director. On the AMS board since 2012, Robyn has focused her attention on two main areas, providing for strong and effective preparation for non-credential administrators of Montessori schools. Through AMS, leaders and mentors, and other professional development opportunities. She's also been part of creating the new AMS Emergent Leader Fellowship Program, which fosters teacher leadership within the AMS community. It is my pleasure and privilege to say thank you on her behalf and introduce you to Martha McDermott, which will accept the award.
It's no secret that I'm not Robyn Breiman. I was asked a couple of weeks ago to do this introduction on behalf of Robyn. It didn't give me very much time, so I'm still in the first period of the three-period lesson in acquiring a New York accent. So bear with me. So it's an honor to do this on Robyn's behalf. Thank you to the Ohio Montessori Alliance. I'm deeply honored to have been chosen to receive this award. I'm so sorry that I'm unable to accept it in person, but delighted that, and honored to, that Martha is willing to accept this on my behalf. I'd like to dedicate this thank you to my teachers. I've been extraordinarily lucky to have had many inspiring teachers. People who have taught and modeled how Montessori is so much more than a profession, how being Montessorian is like being a vegetarian or a humanitarian. It is a commitment and a life choice. But first, a confession. I never wanted to be a teacher. I am the daughter of an extraordinary woman, my first teacher, who was a striver and a force to be reckoned with. As a mother of three in the early 1950s, she fulfilled a lifelong dream and went to college, coming out with an associate's degree and an invitation to join Phi Beta Kappa, a story she never tired of retelling. My mother's professional career began when she took a job as the secretary in a daycare center so that I could go to nursery school. Later, she worked in the New York City public schools, where she prided herself on discerning good principals and teachers and connecting with students, especially the ones who typically got sent to the office. Nevertheless, she encouraged me to become a teacher because teachers get their summers off. Such advice practically ensured that I, the rebellious child of the 60s, wouldn't rebel against it. I chose a college that didn't even offer an education major. And ironically, when I finally did become a teacher, I never taught or trained, just about every summer. After college in 1972, I took an introduction to Montessori at the New School for Social Research. My teacher was Dr. Ruth Selman, a tiny powerhouse of a woman. Dr. Selman was a Montessori pioneer, later named Living Legacy for AMS and the representative for AMS to the United Nations. She had just started a Montessori school in a low-income housing project in New York City. Dr. Selman's intelligence and passion stirred me. It was she who first introduced me to the algebraic trinomial cube and the concept of order. That experience confirmed my interest in Montessori, and since I still needed to figure out what I was going to be when I grew up, at my mother's urging, if you're going to get a certificate, why not get a master's degree? I enrolled in Xavier's master's program in Montessori education and met my first teacher, Hilda Rothschild. There's so much I want to say about Hilda and how I admired her. Her understanding and articulation of Montessori principles, her perceptive observations, and unwavering respect for children. These were powerful models for how to do this work at a very high level. And while that could have been enough, I was also fortunate to have a chance to develop a deeply moving friendship with Hilda. Being with her gave me access and insights to her brilliant mind and delicious sense of humor, and an appreciation for the power of observation in and out of the classroom. From Judy Berger, my first supervising teacher, who had curated art installations before her Montessori career, I learned about how to create beautiful, really beautiful environments. From Martha McDermott, who had just returned from Bergamo to teach elementary at Xavier, I learned to share a fascination with the hand and what one could discover from manipulating materials to show concretized abstractions and to embrace what every child could bring to a lesson, including my six-week-old baby, who distracted us both in her class. From Carol Korngold, my teacher at CMTE, who showed me how to mentor and champion my colleagues and to embrace my inner business bossiness. Carol gave me opportunities for leadership within a context of community. From Biff Mayer, still my colleague and still my teacher, as he is for all of us, from Biff Mayer, still my colleague and still my teacher, I've learned to relish storytelling and to believe in the impact of engagement through narrative. Biff still tells the most intellectually stimulating stories of anyone I know. So I appreciate my teachers, both for what they taught me and for the equally, if not more important, lesson about power of relationship. Each of these amazing teachers also became a mentor and a friend. Through them I learned that with relationship, teaching can be so much more powerful, consequential, even life-changing. These days my Montessori work is in support of new teachers and emerging leaders, so it's especially important for me to thank my teachers. Because of them, I understand how the work we do can have a beautiful ripple effect on those we teach. I will now begin the second period of the three-period lesson.